So, if you look at this, you can understand that regarding what the Euclidean algorithm is, you can, this comes from the very basic concept of mathematics, mainly division. So if you divide a number by another number or another integer, there is two things basically we get as a result. One is the quotient, another is the remainder, right? So, which means that we can write as say if we have 13 by 5 or dividing 13 by 5, we can understand that 5 can go two times and there will be 3 as remainder. Or we can rewrite it in this way, like 13 equal to 2 into 5 plus 3. So division algorithm for integers, we can just generalize in generalized way. We can just write like this, that a equal to qb plus r, where q is the quotient, r is the remainder. Okay, so let's go ahead. Yeah, so here you can see the practical way how Euclidean algorithm works. If you see, say this whole area, you can see in the right side of the screen, say this is the given by this area is given by 100. Okay, and you have been asked to you have to ask to find out GCD of 144. So Euclidean algorithm mainly we use here to find GCD of two numbers. Okay, but it is mainly based on this logic what I have shown you here is based on this division algorithm of for integer. Okay, so how we can find out what will be the GCD of these two number 144 using Euclidean algorithm. Okay, so what we do, we assume that the whole area of the rectangle here is 100. Then what we do, we do a mod operation on 100 by 44, or we just divide 100 by 44 and we try to find out what is the remainder. So what happens here, 2 into 44 gives us 88, and so we can say 12 is going to be the remainder. Then what we do, we take the smallest number and the remainder. So two numbers we had started with, the two numbers 144, so we take the smaller number 44 and the remainder, and then again we do the same operation between these two number 44 and 12. Okay, so if you do this, divide that 44 by 12, you will get 3 as quotient and 8 as remainder. Quotient is not important for our an operation, because we forget quotient here itself, but we just we need this 12 and this remainder 8 for the next round. So in this round we got the smaller number is 12 here, among 44 and 12, smaller is 12, so we take 12 here. Okay, and we take 8 as it is a remainder, so we take 8 and divide 12 by 8, and again we get 4 as remainder. Okay, now the among 12 and 8, 8 is the smaller number, so we take 8 here and we again divide 8 by 4 and we get 0 as remainder. So once, and the same thing you can with the color code you can match, say 44 into 2, so 44, 44 is the yellow part is covered. Okay, so this remaining part is 12 unit. Okay, then when you are dividing 44, when you are dividing 44 by 12, we are getting 3 times 12. So you get this red are the 12 unit, 12 unit, 12 unit. That means the remaining part is basically 3 equal unit you have divided, and you got this in a blue and green part is remaining, which is 8 unit. Okay, then again when you are doing 12 divided by 8, you are getting quotient 1. That means in one part out of this, one part is this blue part is 8, is divisible, and 4, that means these green parts are remainder. Again, when you are doing 8 by 4, so 2 times 4 is running, going, so this green part is going to be, divided into 2 part, 4 unit and 4 unit. So, and the remainder is right now is 0. Okay, so finally, when you are getting remainder 0 in this process, at that step, and at which step you got remainder 0, what was the divisor? That is the GCD of the two number. So GCD of 144 is 4. Okay, so this is the way how we can calculate GCD of two number using Euclidean algorithm. So if you look at as a form of algorithm, we can write it like this: input are A and B, who belongs to R. R is set of all integers. So A and B are the two number. Here these two number can be think about 144. Okay, and output will be GCD G of these two number, and that G must again belongs to the same R, which is a set of integer. Okay, now we initialize R0 to A, R1 to B, and iteration, I equal to 2, which is this I is going to going to be act as a iteration counter or loop counter. Okay, so while R I minus 1, so I is 2 we have given, so it is going to be 2 minus 1, that's R1 not equal to 0. So R1 is B right now, so if it is not equal to 0, then you repeat these two steps, R I, that means R2 for the first time, equal to R I minus 2, that means R0, remainder R I minus 1. Okay, and increase I by one step, and iterate it until you are getting RI minus 1 equal to 0. That means remainder is 0. Once you get remainder 0, you stop iterating and return RI minus 2. Okay, so you can see here you are iterating this, and these are the remainder. Okay, so here we get the value of R equal to 0. So R minus 2 will give you the previous iteration, value of R, which is 4. So that will be returned as a GCD. Okay, so you can understand this. So why here it is written I minus 2? Because we have initialized I with 2, so you can understand it is always running one step ahead. Okay, so that is the reason. Now Euclidean algorithm, some example you can find here. Say find out GCD of 81 and 57. Okay, so simply looking at this, many people may think that what will be the GCD, but using Euclidean algorithm you can easily find out what is the GCD of 81 and 57. So the same method is applied here, and finally you can see in the final round, the R remainder is going to be 0, so 3 will be the GCD of these two number. Okay, then so this is the logic used here, so you can understand. I have already this logic is what is used here. Okay, now what is the point coming out of all this thing is that if the GCD of A and B is R, then there exist integers P and S, so that PA and SB, PA plus SB, okay, equal to R. Okay, so if you just reverse these steps, you can understand this in better way. See, the last step was 9 equal to 1 into 6 plus 3. So that can be written like this: 3 equal to 9 minus 1 into 6. You understand? Because we got 3 as remainder only because 6 goes 1 time out of 9. Okay? So if that means 1 into 6, just take this element on the other side of the equal sign. So this element will go on the other side like this, 9 minus 1 into 6, and 3 plus 3 will be in this side, so equal to plus 3. So if we just rewrite this operation in this way, then the last line can be written like this. Then from the line before that, we see that 6 equal to 24 minus 2 into 9. Correct? So we can say that 3 equal to 9. So you are combining this one and this one. Okay. So in together we can say that 3 equal to 9 minus 1 into 1 into 6 was there, but 6 is what? 24 minus 2 into 9. So 1 into 24 minus 29. Okay. And by simplifying this a little bit, we can write 3 equal to 3 into 9 minus 1 into 24. Because if you just simplify it, you can understand that this 9 is here. Here is another 9. So this the minus it will be plus. So 19 and 2 times 9. So it is 3 times 9. And here minus 1 times 24. So minus 1 times 24. Okay. So from the line before that, we have the we have 9 equal to from this line, okay, from this line 9 equal to 57 minus 2 into 24. So again we do the same thing and we get 3 equal to 3 into 57 minus 7 into 24. Again we take the first line here in on the on your left hand, and this line we rewrite, okay, in the same way, and we can get 3 equal to 3 into 57 minus 7 into 81 minus 1 into 57. And if we just simplify this, we will get 3 equal to 10 into 57 minus 7 into 87. So that now you compare this last line with this PA plus SB equal to R. So here R is 3, 10 is P, A is 57, okay, and the plus sign you can assume it is plus is there, and minus 7 in bracket you can assume, okay, plus, so minus 7 into 81, so minus 7 is S and 81 is B, right? So what if the bottom line is that if there is a R exists, R is the GCD of A and B, then it must be possible to rewrite this equation in this form, that is PA into SB equal to R. Okay. Now come to extended Euclidean algorithm. So yeah, what is the takeout out of this? There are two things mainly. One thing is that we, using Euclidean algorithm, we can just find out the GCD of two numbers. Another thing is that if we just come back from the last step to the first step by just rewriting and reversing the steps, we can come to this point that we can write any number P into A, S into B equal to R. Okay. Now extended Euclidean algorithm, what it does, it basically also finds this P and S also at the with same time it is finding R. Okay. So the extended Euclidean algorithm is extension of Euclidean algorithm which computes in addition to the greatest common divisor GCD of positive integers A and B the coefficient S and T which satisfy the equation Sx plus Ty equals to GCD of AB. Okay. So for example, let A equal to 240, B equal to 46, then the addition to calculating GCD of 240 46 equal to 2, The extended Euclidean algorithm also finds S and T. The S is for this case, we'll get S equal to 23 and T equal to minus 120. Now, how does it work? It, you know, in the for the first two, you know, it can be represented in a table. The first two rows, you can see that quotients, there is no entry. For remainder, you can see the bigger number is put in the remainder first and smaller number in the second row. Okay, and SI is initialized to 1 here and 0 then, and TI is the is 0 for the first first row and 1 for the second row. So this is, you can just think about a configuration of the algorithm at the beginning. So the execution of the algorithm basically starts from the third row or even the 12th row. Okay, so what it does, calculates the coefficient of these two numbers. You can understand it will be 5. Okay, then it calculates the remainder. We can simply understand remainder is going to be 10. Okay, now once you get these two things, it calculates 1 minus 5. So you can see 5 is the quotient, and the quotient into this second row value or the previous row value of S. Okay, this equal to what? If you calculate and simplify, 5 into 0 is 0 and 1 is there, so 1. So equal to 1. Okay, so it will always use the previous two values of SI. Okay, so if it is SI 2 here, so SI 1 and SI 0 will be used. On the next row, when SI 3 will be considered here, then SI 2 and SI 1 will be used. Okay, and so on. And for the T also the same thing is going on. So in this way it is going repeatedly, and finally in the when you are going to get the remainder is 0, you can declare what is the GCD and what is your GCD is 2. That means when you are getting 0 at that point, you will look at the previous remainder. Previous remainder was 2, so you can say that GCD is 2. Okay, and here you can see that 23 is the value of SI when you got remainder 0, and minus 20 you are getting the value of TI when you are getting the remainder 0. So the final value of S will be given as 23, and final value of T will be given as 120. I think I made it clear to all of you. So modular multiplicative inverse using extended Euclidean algorithm. So few things are here you need to look at, like px plus sn equal to 1. So previously what we was discussing, that px and xn are from here, if you see pa plus sb equal to r, here also it is equal to r, or that is written as gcd ab. Okay, so here it is saying that px plus sn equal to 1. Okay, that means the remainder is going to be 1. Okay, not remainder gcd. Okay, then px equal to 1 plus, you take this term on the other side, so minus s into n. So we can write px congruent 1 mod n. Okay, so this is the things, simple calculation we have discussed in the previous session also regarding modular arithmetic. Okay, so here it is, modular multiplicative inverse. Okay, so P, reduced mod n if needed be. So P is the inverse of x mod n. So you can say, because you can see here P into x, congruent to 1. So you can say that P is the inverse of x. extended Euclidean algorithm gives a method for calculating p efficiently. Okay. So finding inverse. Okay. So say something is given you. So we have to find out what is the multiplicative inverse of that. So how we can do it? Basically, we again maintain a table to calculate this. Say two number. You are given with say two numbers. Okay. A and B, and Qi is the quotient of quotient of pith iteration, and R is the remainder of pith iteration. And on the other side, you also calculate Pi equal to Pi minus 2 minus Pi minus 1 into Qi minus 2 mod n. Now, the first two rows are kind of configuration rows. What is the multiplicative inverse of 15 mod 26? Understand, what is the multiplicative inverse of 15 in mod 26 arithmetic? You can speak like this, or you can say it like this, or you can say what is the multiplicative inverse of 15 mod 26. Okay, so this is the thing. That means you are doing arithmetic where you can cycle of digits basically repeats after 24 steps. You have 26 steps only, and after that it is going to be remainder, or you understand this. Okay, so our target is finding out multiplicative inverse of 15 in mod 26 operation. So first two rows you can see 26 is the bigger number, so in the same as your Euclidean algorithm, you are writing 26 equal to 1 times 15 plus 11, so 11 is the remainder, 1 is quotient, and here P0 equal to 0 is fixed. So this is the configuration of the algorithm. We don't need to calculate P0 at this step. Then again take the bigger number this side, 15, so 15 equal to 11 is the smaller number, so 1 times 11 plus 4, so 4 is remainder here, but here also P1 equal to 1, it is fixed. So you don't need to update it. Okay. Next is the smaller of 15 and 11 was 11. So take 11 here. So and 4 was the remainder. So 4 goes, 2 times 4 plus 3 gives you 11. So 2 is the quotient, 3 is the remainder. Now we can calculate P2 here because it is step 2. So Pi equal to 2. So P2 equal to P2 minus 2. That means P0. So P0 is already 0 here. So 0 minus pi minus 1, so I is 2, then p1, p1 is 1 here, so bring 1 here, multiplication with qi minus 2, qi minus 2 means q 0, qi minus, yeah, I is 2, qi minus 2 means q 0. All right, so in the next time, in the next step, 3, I equal to 3, you have Q equal to 1, R equal to 1. So P3 equal to P and I3 minus 2, then P1. So P1 is 1 came here, minus P3 minus 1, then P2. P2 is already we have 25, 25 came here, into Q3 minus 1, Q1. So Q1 is here, that is 1 already. Okay, so 25 into 1 mod 26. So what we are getting here, 1 minus 25, that means minus 24, minus 24 mod 26 equal to 2. Okay, now step 4 in the same way going on, and we are getting P4 here is equal to 21. So at this point, when we are getting P4 equal to 21, you can see our remainder becomes 0. So once our remainder becomes 0, we stop. Okay, so we stopped here, but on the other side we will just calculate one step more for P5. Okay, so when we calculate P5, we have all the values available. Okay, using all those value, we will get this equal to 7. So the here one thing we need to remember, that at the step 4 or at step 4, if we are getting remainder 0, we have to calculate up to P5, and one step ahead we have to calculate on the P side, P calculation side. So we are getting 7 here, okay? So we can say that 7 is the multiplicative inverse of 15 mod 26. Clear? No. So here we can compute a polynomial fx equal to n x to the power n plus n minus 1, x to the power n minus 1, and so on, or which can be also written as summation of ai x to the power I, actually it should be. Okay, so this is say given a polynomial, where ai are the element of some designated set of number s called the coefficient set, and an can't be zero, basically. Yes, an can't be zero. Okay, and n should be greater than equal to zero. That means the degree of the polynomial should be greater than equal to zero. We say that such polynomials are defined over the coefficient set S. Note that not interested in the in any specific value of x. So what is the value of x? We are not interested at this moment. Okay, so it can be anything. We are not interested of that, which is known as the indeterminate. Okay, so this thing. So ordinary polynomial arithmetic, if you look at this, add or subtract corresponding coefficients or multiply all terms by each other. So this is what the two basic rule. So if you have as a two polynomial, fx is given as x to the power q x square plus 2, and gx is given as x square plus minus x plus 1. So if I ask you to add these two polynomial, it can be given like this: fx plus gx equal to x cube plus 2x square minus x plus 3. That means it is simply added, 1x cubes, 1x cube came here, 1x square here, another x square here, it becomes 2x square, and 1x is minus x is here, so minus x came here, plus 2 and plus 1 plus 3. So you understand all these calculation, these are the very basic arithmetic, so I am not discussing them. This is a subtraction. So the gx is subtracted from fx, and this is the result came, and multiplication. So in multiplication, you know what happens, that we multiply one element with all the element of the other polynomial. Again, you take another element of the second polynomial and multiply all the element with that, with the the second element, and we go so on, and we get the result. So that is the thing we get as a multiplication. I have already told you addition, subtraction, and multiplication. Now division, you can do it like this. This is also you have done in your school life. This is a very simple thing. Okay, so first time this polynomial goes x times out of this. So x into this polynomial. So here you are writing the cost. So x you get first. So x cube minus x square plus x, okay? Then you subtract them out. So the x cube cancelled. Then this is going to be plus sign. So 2x square you will get going to have. Then doing subtraction, so this is going to be a negative sign. So minus x plus 2 you will get. Then you again will just, it will go 2 times. So, okay, this polynomial. So 2 into this polynomial. Okay, and subtract these two, and you will get a remainder x. Okay, so once you will get the remainder in form which is having the degree less than the divisor, then you have to stop and you have to declare this as a remainder. Okay, so polynomial arithmetic with modulo coefficient. So in computing value of each coefficient, do calculation modulo some value. Say forms of polynomial ring, okay, could be modulo of any prime, but we are most interested in mod 2 operation, and I have already told you why. Because in computer many things will represent in binary, so we need to do modulo 2 operation all these cases. So that means in the mod 2 operation you will have coefficients 0 and 1 only. Okay, let fx equal to x cube plus x square, and gx equal to x square plus x plus 1. And if you do addition right now, see, you had done addition previously without modulo. Now here if you do addition of fx plus gx with mod 2, what is going to happen? Xsq, only one xsq is there, so xsq is coming here as it is. Then x square is here, here x square is here. So x square plus x square, you will have 2x square. So 2x square, that means 2 is the coefficient, 2 mod 2 is 0, and 0 into x square, so x square is cancelled. So in the result, x square is not there. Okay, then you got plus x, so coefficient is 1. So 1 mod 2 is 1, so x is added here, and here you have only 1. Again, 1 mod 2 is 1, so 1 is added here. Okay, then here it is, multiplication is done. So in the same way, you can see x cube and x square multiplied, you got x to the power 5 with coefficient 1, so it remains here. But if you see x cube plus x, it gives you x to the power 4. Again here x square into x square, it will also give you x to the power 4. So you will going to have 2x4. Okay, 2x to the power 4, 20x to the power 4. So coefficient you will have 2. So 2 mod 2 will cancel, will be 0. So 0 into x to the power 4 will be 0. So x to the power 4 is not there in the result. Understand? And so on, it is calculated that the reason the result is x to the power 5 plus x square. Okay. Then polynomial division can. Write any polynomial in the form fx equal to qx gx plus rx. So you can remember the equation when you had written some number a equal to qb plus r. So that is the same thing here. It is written fx equal to qx plus qx gx plus rx. Okay. Can be interpreted as Rx being the remainder, and Rx for the fx mod gx. Have no remainder, say gx simply divides fx, so then Rx basically will not be there. There will be no remainder polynomial. Okay, and if gx has no divisor other than itself, then 1. And one, say, irreducible or prime polynomial. That means if you get the remainder is only gx itself or one, then you will call this polynomial as a prime or irreducible polynomial. You don't call them prime. Usually they are called as irreducible polynomial. Okay. So many times, I think from your school life, you have many times heard about irreducible polynomial. Basically, this is nothing but a polynomial which cannot be divisible by another n polynomial, okay, except only one, okay, R itself. Arithmetic modulo and irreducible polynomial forms a field. So if you take arithmetic modulo of a irreducible polynomial, it will give you a field. Now polynomial GCD. You can find GCD for polynomials as well. So say CX equal to GCD of AX BX. Okay, so two polynomials are given, AX and BX, and if you take GCD of them, you can have a GCD result CX. Okay, if CX is a polynomial of greatest degree, which can divide both ax and gx. Okay, so it's definitely, as it is a GCD polynomial, so it will do that. But can adopt Euclidean's Euclid's algorithm to find this cx. So it is something like this. The algorithm looks like ax equal to ax and capital bx equal to bx. And if capital bx equal to 0, return ax equal to GCD of ax comma bx. And if no, this is okay. If that means that if the remainder becomes 0, basically you return the ax, which will be the GCD of the given polynomial. And if not, then rx equal to ax mod bx okay, and you do it, continue doing it, okay. Then you again go back step two and check that whether you are going to get BX equal to zero or not. Again, you repeat the same operations, okay. Modular polynomial arithmetic, it can be computed in Gauss-Field 2 to the power n. Polynomials with coefficients modulo 2, which degree is less than n, hence must reduce modulo an irreducible polynomial of degree n. Okay, so for multiplication only. So form a finite field, so it forms a finite field, can always find an inverse, and it will always allow you to find the inverse, can extend Euclid's inverse algorithm to find. So you can use the extended Euclid's algorithm. Okay, so here is the calculation how it can be done. Okay, so you can see here polynomial arithmetic modulo x to the power q plus x plus 1. Okay, and for example, it is given that 111 plus 101 equal to 010 from modulo 2 viewpoint. Thus, the result is 0x square plus 1x plus 0 into 1 equal to x. So you can see in this side also these polynomials are given. Here also these polynomials are given. So addition result, if you just add this polynomial with this polynomial, it will give 0 and so on. You can all the addition results are given in the table. And here in this, you can see all the multiplication results are given in the table. Okay. So what is the good thing about this is that you don't need to multiply all the time. You just look at this table and you can just find it out. Okay. Computational consideration, since coefficients are 0 and 1, can represent any such polynomial as bit string. Addition becomes a jar of these bit strings, and multiplication is shift and jar. Then CF, longhand multiplication, and modulo reduction done by repeatedly substituting the highest power with the remainder of irreducible polynomial. Also, okay, also shift and jar operations. Okay, so these are the computational consideration, and you can see all of them are first order operations. So if you are able to convert one of your problem into Gauss-Field 2 to the power n problem, then it is going to be easier to calculate. Okay. Computational example, here is some example is given. Then using a generator, you can use a generator. Then equivalent definition of finite field, the generator G is an element whose power generate all non-zero elements. If f is 0, g to the power 0, and so on, can create generator from root of the irreducible polynomial. Okay, so then implement multiplication by adding exponents or of the generator. Okay, so basically many times we will need generators for different reason. We may need random number generator, we may need polynomial generator, we may need prime number generators. Okay, so that irreducible polynomials are very, very important for using as generator.